Hi, this is Scott Erickson with DTG from Tampa, Florida. Welcome to our video on the new Epson P800 17-inch printer. Now, the P800 fits between the new Epson P600 at 13-inch and the existing Epson 4900 17-inch with roll built into it. Big difference when you're considering these printers. Think about your application, not only the size that you need to print, but also your cost per square foot. With a 4900, you've got much larger ink tanks, 200 milliliter ink tanks. With the P800, you're down to 80 milliliters, and the P600, you're down below 25. And that basically equates to around 43 cents per milliliter on the Epson 4900. 69 cents on the Epson P800, and then finally $1.24 per milliliter on the P600. So when considering a 17-inch or a desktop printer, the 13-inch and the P600, think about how much you're going to print and how much it's going to cost you to do those prints. Now the P800 is basically the exact same ink set as the P600. It's an 8+1 ink set, plus one meaning it has both blacks, photo black and matte black, to print on both photo media and matte fine art media. It features the new Ultrachrome HD ink set. Now the new HD ink set has been completely reformulated. It's got a new resin encapsulation, which yields a much greater D-max, up to 1.5 times as great. And with our HDR profiles, we're actually seeing even greater than that in our D-max. Basically, the new HD ink is also up to 2 times as archival in the print permanence ratings. These are ongoing at Wilhelm Imaging Research, but so far up to 2 times in print longevity. The P800 also has an optional roll feed for under $200. You can add that at any time. It's got built-in USB 2.0, Ethernet, as well as wireless N capability. It will connect to the older G style, but we don't really recommend that because of speed issues. It does have a built-in color touch display for navigating the front panel, checking ink levels, doing nozzle checks, things like that. It is important to point out that it doesn't have a cutter built in. Again, an advantage of the Epson 4900. It does do border-free printing on, you know, your more popular common sizes like 4x6, 16x20, etc. You can check literature on specifics on the border-free. And then finally, it supports wireless printing through Apple AirPrint and Google Cloud Print, which is a nice convenient feature, not necessarily for professional photo imaging, but can be nice if you want to quickly print from your iPhone or your Android phone or your iPad. What we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and continue on. This is the Epson P800 box. It's not too big, approximately 21 by 31 by 16-ish in size. So it's not too big to handle. Doesn't come in on a pallet, so there's no pallet involved with that. Moving forward, what we're going to go ahead and do is unbox this, show you the contents, and then show you how to set up and use the Epson P800. Okay, so this is a bird's eye view of the top of the box. We went ahead and scored and opened the box there on the top. One thing I want to point out is on the side of the box is the Epson UPC code. I'm going to go ahead and score and take that off and remove it from the box, and then basically put that with my documentation, my invoice. You never know when this can come in handy if there's any kind of promotions or rebates. Once we open the box, you can see inside we've got our ink tanks, our documentation, and then the printer itself. So we can just start unpacking the inks, and then we'll just lift the printer out and set it on our desk. So we've unboxed the printer with the ink cartridges. It's the printer itself, and then here is the documentation along with the power cord. Now inside the documentation, we do have the Epson SureColor P800 Start Here Guide, which basically walks you through setting this thing up, kind of like this video. But if you're more of a visual person, we'll go ahead and set this up. So first, we're going to have to remove all of the packing tape that's on the printer, all this blue tape, the cellophane, and then also the locking mechanism, which I'll show you here in a second. So I'm going to go ahead and start on this, and get all of this removed, and then we'll show you how to remove the transportation block. So as you can see, we've pretty much got all the packing material removed. We opened up the front cover, moved this styrofoam. We've also got a note on here, which basically is keeping the print head assembly kind of locked in over to the right. We're just going to kind of follow this string and then pull to the left and then just remove this piece that locks the print head down to the carriage. So basically at this point we can go ahead and plug in the printer, turn it on, and then it's going to walk us through configuring the rest, including loading the ink tanks. So we've got the printer plugged in. What we'll do is go ahead and turn it on. I'm going to close, push all the trays back in, go ahead and close the drawer. Power button's actually right here, but just so you know, I can swing the display up towards me, so it's a lot easier to operate. So I'm just going to go ahead and hit the button in the lower left-hand corner. The printer will go ahead and turn on and initialize itself. At this point, it's asking me to select a language. So we can scroll up or scroll down and select a language. Here, we're going to select English. And once I push the English word, it's going to go ahead and start to initialize. After a few seconds, it will automatically pop the ink cover, and we'll go ahead and load the ink cartridges. So after about 45 seconds, the ink cover pops up, so we can lift it up, and then also on the front panel, it lets us know to go ahead and install these ink cartridges. So we've gone ahead and taken the cartridges out of the bags. Just a real quick on this last one, the bags have actually a little tear notch on the on one end of them, so it makes it a lot easier to open up. So just grab that tear notch and just pull down. Before you put ink cartridges into the printer, what you want to do is just go ahead and give them a little bit of shake. I usually like to do three or four at a time, so I don't have to sit there and individually shake each ink tank. Also note, these are initialization ink cartridges. They are 64 milliliters, not the full 80 milliliters. And it does take a little bit of the ink in the charging process, so you don't get a full set of inks in terms of use when you buy the new printer. You get these smaller initialization cartridges. So what we're going to do, they don't have to go in any order. You can just start randomly inserting the inks. So what we'll do is just go ahead and push them in, and you'll hear a click. Now, the ink cartridges are labeled with an arrow pointing into the direction to which they need to go in. And then they're also labeled on the back side. So this says LLK. I'm going to find LLK on the top of the printer. Arrow up and pointing in. And push it in until it clicks. So we'll continue on with the rest of these inks. And then we'll pick up and show you what happens after we put the last ink tank in. So we're ready to put the last ink tank in. Also on the front panel color display, it's actually showing you which tanks are inserted and which tanks are not inserted with a red X. All right, so we'll go ahead and pop that last one in. Red X disappears. It basically says close the cover. And at this point, it's going to go ahead and charge or prime the printer with the ink tanks. It's really important to note, you don't want to turn the printer off or unplug the printer in the middle of this process, because if you do, it will actually have to start completely over and waste more ink. So try to let this sit. It'll take probably anywhere from 8 to 10 minutes, but once that's finished and it's primed, you're ready to continue on. So once the ink tanks have finished charging, basically the printer will be ready. On the front panel of the display, it'll show the load guide, which will assist you in loading paper. What we wanted to do at this point is bring in the Epson 4900. Again, if you guys are still considering which printer to buy, this kind of gives you a good reference as far as the size of these printers. The P800, which is 17 inches wide, versus the P600, which is 13 inches wide, in terms of the print path, is actually barely bigger than the P600. It's 2 to 3 inches wider, about the same in depth. Considering that desk space and all that, it's not much bigger on the P800. From the 4900 standpoint, you can see that the 4900 is much wider than both of these printers, because one of the additional orange and green ink tanks, the larger ink tanks, so it's much more of a more substantial piece of a printing equipment. What we're going to continue on with now is continue setting up the P800. And according to the guide, it just kind of walks you through loading paper. But what we're also going to do is do the print head alignment so that we get the best possible print quality.
Okay, so what we're going to do is go ahead and load paper and do a print head alignment at this point. So loading paper is in that startup guide, but the printhead alignment procedure is not. So this is where we kind of divert a little bit from that written instruction startup guide that you've got with the printer. Now to load paper, there's several different ways to load paper with the Epson P800. We've got the rear auto feeder, meaning you can stack several sheets depending on the thickness of the media. In your documentation is the actual number of sheets that you can stack per the type of media. So the thinner the media, the more that you can stack. In the front is the output tray, typically, but it's also, which extends, but it's also the manual load as well. So what I did to bring that out was I just pushed it in and it sprung out. This is where I'm going to load fine art and thick heavy paper. And then finally I could load poster board in here as well, so I can actually print on thick, rigid poster board in this printer. So I'm going to push that back because we're not going to use that now for the print head alignment. Actually, I'm going to leave that open so we can output the sheets. I'm going to stack my sheets of luster that came with the printer. I'm going to stack that in the auto sheet feeder. This gray slider adjusts depending on how wide your paper is. So I'm going to put the print side facing towards you in the camera, so print side facing me, all the way lined up to the right edge. I'm going to take my guide and I'm going to press that flush against my paper. So you notice I'm putting it in tall as well. I don't want to do one of these numbers. So whether it's 13 by 19, 8.5 by 11, 16 by 20, put it in tall, and then if you're really tall, you can extend this to offer support for those tall sheets. All right, so once I've got it loaded, there's an actual sensor inside the printer. What we'll do is we'll cut away and we'll get a close-up of the front panel of the printer so you can see actually what it's saying. Okay, so as discussed before, the sensor automatically picked up that I was loading paper in the auto sheet feeder. In fact, watch when I pull this out, it actually goes back to the home menu. As soon as I put the paper back in, it takes me automatically to what paper size am I putting. If I wanted to change this, I do have letter size paper, but if I wanted to change it, I could hit these left and right arrows to specify which size paper in there I have in there. Also the paper type. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and select, this is the premium luster photo paper, so I'm going to select premium luster as my page selection, or my media selection. This has everything, has nothing to do with color, but has everything to do with the paper thickness, all right, that I'm loading in the machine, so it can auto adjust the print head height and the feed mechanism. So once I make those selections, I'm going to go ahead and hit OK. To do the print head alignment, I'm going to click on the lower right icon, which is the wrench and the screwdriver, to take us into the setup menu. I'm going to go to maintenance, so I'm going to push the maintenance option, and then I'm going to use the down arrow to go all the way down to where it says print head alignment. I'm going to select print head alignment, and basically tells me to load, you know, the correct paper in the printer, which we've already done, and then I'm going to hit print. All right, once I hit print, this is going to print out the print head alignment pattern, which I'm going to look at and actually choose the best alignment pattern and enter back into the printer. Once this prints, we'll go ahead and cover that to show you how to do that. Again, this is real important to make sure that you get the best, highest quality prints out of your P800. Okay, so after about 10, 15 minutes, two pages of the print alignment pattern have printed out, and we're basically going to enter 12 values. When it finishes, it automatically takes you to the screen that allows you to enter the value that you chose on the prints. So it says number one, the default value is 5. So I have a choice, and you'll see this in a second, of the values between 1 and 9. Just by chance, I did choose 5 for that first one. Now, just so you know, if I had chosen 2, I would just hit the down arrow. If I had chosen 7 or 8, I can hit the up arrow. But I'm going to go ahead and hit 5 because 5 was the value I chose on the printouts. You'll see in a second. And then I'm going to hit proceed. And that's going to basically take me to number 2. And I'm going to keep entering these values until I get all 12 entered. So here's a shot of the actual paper, the first sheet that came out. Moving kind of from left to right, it gives me 9 boxes. And some of those boxes have very big gaps, white lines. Some of them have overlapping lines. What I'm doing is I'm picking the box, all right, with the cleanest look. no overlap or very little overlap or no, you know, dark lines represented. So in this first row, number 5 was the winner. And the second row, number 3 was. So I basically go to the front panel of the printer and I'll enter number 3 for the second row. Then I'll proceed, then I'll enter number 3, which was a 4 value. And again, I visually looked at this already and I circled them. So that's kind of a, you know, quick tip for you. Just basically pick them, pick all 12 rows, and this is the second sheet. Pick all 12 rows with a pen and then go to the front panel of the printer and enter them. So before we go ahead and start loading drivers and software, I wanted to show you how to use the front manual feed for thicker fine art paper or poster board. To load fine art paper, I'm going to go ahead and open the front panel, and then I'm going to push the manual feed tray, and it'll eject out towards me. Again, the printer recognizes the fact that I'm wanting to feed paper through here. Now, one real important thing with loading fine art paper is I'm going to open up on the back panel is a rear tray. So I'm just going to flip that out, all right, towards the back so that the paper can come up and out. With thick poster board or rigid media, it's the opposite. I actually close that rear output tray. And again, it's just a little handle. It's very obvious once you get to the back of the machine. Just kind of swing it out, all right, so it's at an angle so that the paper can come out. So once I'm ready to load the thicker fine art paper, I'm just going to go ahead and feed that in print side up. And I'm going to line that up on the pushing it all the way to the right and then looking at the front left-hand side. Now, the front panel is kind of walking me through this as well. So I'm just basically at this point, since I've got the paper in there, it senses that. I'm going to hit the load button. All right. And it's going to go ahead and feed the media. You'll see it kind of pop up out of the back. And if it's happy, if I loaded it in straight, it'll be at the screen position asking me what the size of the paper is, as well as what type of paper that we saw with the auto sheet feed load as well. So what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and push the manual tray, and we're going to select what size. It happens to be 13 by 19. The printer does guess based on the width of the media, so this is a 13 by 19 sheet. And then I'm going to enter the paper type. So I'm going to enter my paper type. If my paper type's not listed here, I'm going to pick something similar. So for example, this is the textured watercolor paper, and that's actually not in the list. So I'm going to pick something similar, which would be something like the ultra smooth fine art or the velvet fine art, just something similar in thickness, and then just click OK. Once I click OK, the paper's loaded and I'm ready to print to it. Okay, so we want to go ahead and show you the front panel and some of the features as well. On the front panel, what you may be accessing, one of the, on the far lower left, you've got your ink levels. You can also open the ink cover if you need to change an ink at any point or if it's out. What we'll do is we'll go ahead and hit the back button, which is to the left, right over here. It's a arrow pointing to the left, very obvious, to get back to the home screen. The next option is the black ink switch. So basically this will manually change the printer from photo black to matte black or vice versa. Now, real good point, when you're using this printer, when it changes from photo to matte black, it does purge some of that ink. Anywhere from 1.5 to 3.5 or 4.5 milliliters of ink. So, you know, this can cost you a little bit of money when you're switching back and forth. So you want to try to gang your jobs, do all the photo black ink jobs, and then switch to the matte black. Don't be constantly switching back and forth because it does cost some money to do that. This is the Wi-Fi setup. Again, you can connect to this via Wi-Fi. We do recommend wireless N. You can connect to the wireless G or the slower networks, but it will dramatically slow down the printer in most cases. So in all honesty, if you're printing in a business environment, we recommend hard wiring either with a USB 2.0 or an Ethernet cable. So again, I'm just going to hit that back arrow to the left and then finally show you the maintenance or the setup menu. We've got the maintenance submenu, the system administration, network status, and then print a status sheet. I'm going to go ahead and hit the maintenance button. Here's where you can do your nozzle checks, your print head cleanings, power cleaning, or now it's called a heavy head cleaning, the paper guide cleaning, and as you scroll down here, you can see the head alignment, which we went into earlier. Let's print a print head nozzle check just to make sure all the jets are firing, so I can just push that. I've loaded plain paper in the auto sheet feed, which is more than adequate to do a print head nozzle check. You don't need to do that on photo paper or fine art paper. Just put plain paper in your printer and print the nozzle check on plain paper. So this is going to go through the actual process of printing a nozzle check, and then we'll eject the paper, and we'll go ahead and take a look at that nozzle check so you know what to look for. Now you can also do this actually from your computer screen as well with the utility, and it will show you, you know, exactly what your how your print head nozzles are looking. So basically, I don't know if you guys can see that, but each one of these stair steps, and if you own an Epson printer, it's the exact same pattern, is a nozzle, and in what you're looking for is gaps or missing lines or anything like that. So that's a print head nozzle check. Okay, as with other Epson professional printers, the P800 does feature a maintenance or waste tank. To change that out, you can access it right here on the bottom front right. I'm just going to pull that forward and then pull the ink tank towards me. All right, it's not empty right now, but I just wanted to show you how to do that, or filled right now. So to replace it, just push it in and then close that tank cover, and the printer will check that it is a tank that can be used, and once it's finished checking that, it's ready to go. Now to change ink tanks or ink cartridges, again, you saw that from earlier, the lower left hand button allows me to get into the ink menu and check the ink levels. Well, here I can hit the open ink cover button, and it's going to go ahead and eject or power open that cover, which allows me access to those inks. So to get them out, I just push the gray cover down, or gray switch, and then pull it out. Again, if this was a brand new ink tank, I'd want to shake it mildly for about 5 to 10 seconds before I inserted it, push it in, and it clicks. So again, push down, it ejects, pull it out, replace the ink tank, and put it back in. So once I'm done replacing whatever ink tank I need to replace, close the cover. The printer's going to check that the ink tanks are valid. Once it does that, it'll take us back to the home menu and we're ready to print. So at this point, pretty much shown you the features of the printer. We're going to go ahead and install the software and show you how to download those. One of the things we're not showing you is the optional roll feeder. We actually, this is a brand new printer. We don't have our optional roll feeder yet. We will do an addendum, an additional video to show you how to use the roll feeder. But at this point, we'll go ahead and continue on with loading the software. Okay, so now we'll continue with installing the drivers for your computer. As with other Epson printers, we do recommend that you do download the latest drivers from Epson.com. And in case of the P800, at least in the initial box, there's actually no driver discs, so you have to download those. But that ensures that you've got the latest drivers for your operating system. So we'll just go ahead and go to Epson.com and show you how easy and quick it is to find that. We'll go to drivers and support, then go down to professional imaging. We'll just type in P800 in this product search and then select our printer. Once we select it, it takes us to the options. So we'll go to drivers and downloads. You'll notice that the browser automatically detects our computer and operating system. If we were on a different computer or we were installing the drivers on a different computer, we could go ahead, click on this list, and then select the appropriate driver. It also automatically recommends what we should download, and that would be, in this case, the drivers and utilities combo package, which is basically all the software we need for the P800. So we'll just go ahead and click on that and then click the download button, and the download will begin. So in here, we're using the Safari browser on the Mac. We can click up here just to check our progress. Depending on your internet connection, this can take, you know, a few seconds up to a couple of minutes, so just be patient while it downloads. So once that's finished downloading, I can either access the file directly from the Safari download shortcut, or just go to my Finder and then go to my downloads and then locate the recently downloaded file. So I'll double click that DMG file, which will mount
the installer, and then I'll just double click the Epson icon. We'll continue on with this installer. Now it's important to note we have not plugged in the Epson printer to our computer through USB or through Ethernet at this point. We'll plug that in at a later point. So we'll just continue through the installer wizard. It's asking us what we want to install. I'm going to go ahead and select the software updater, which will basically automatically install updates and firmware updates and things like that. And then we can also install the user guide link, which will help us if we ever need help in using the printer. So we'll just click install, type in our password, and then continue on. The installer takes, depending on the computer, can take anywhere from 30 seconds or so to a couple of minutes. So just be patient while that installs. So once the software finishes installing, the printer setup wizard begins. So we'll just go ahead and click start. And it asks us what our connection is. And what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and select wired network connection and hit continue. We're going to go ahead and set up the printer for the first time, hit continue. And then we're going to go ahead and plug in our computer to, our printer into our Ethernet network. So we've connected our P800 to our network. I'm now going to continue and add the printer. In the Macintosh, it will automatically see the printer on the network. If we're on a Windows, we may want to set the IP address from the front panel of the P800. But again, on the Mac, we'll go ahead and select the P800. And then we're going to click on the Use, and then we're going to make sure we select the Epson SCP-800 series driver. Okay, we don't want to let it default. We want to make sure we select the specific Epson driver because that's going to give us all the features. Then we'll click Add. And then we'll just click Continue. We could print a test page at this point. I'm not going to waste the paper and ink. We'll just hit Continue. And we're pretty much finished with the installation of the Epson P800 driver and software. So now we're going to go ahead and show you how to install the driver on the Windows platform. This is the drivers and utilities download that I did from the website. So we'll just launch that. And then we'll step through the wizard as it installs the printer driver and utilities. So I'll go ahead and click accept and install everything. It'll go out to the internet and go ahead and proceed to install. The next step is to pick how your printer is connected. Now, if you are connecting to directly to your computer via USB, just select this, click next, and it will basically ask you to plug in the printer. And as soon as it plugs in, it'll find it and then install the driver. Now we're on a wired network connection, so I would click this. When I click next, it's asking me set it up for the first time or if it's already on my Ethernet network. All right, it's already on, so I'm going to hit next and then click next again. Now this launches a utility which goes out over your network and tries to find the printer. Well, it just so happens on our network, it did not automatically find the printer. So after troubleshooting a bit, I went ahead and downloaded just the printer driver from Epson.com. So instead of this, I actually installed or downloaded and am going to install that. So this is that download. So I'll launch that. Click yes. Okay. And then I'm going to click okay. Agree to the terms. And then I'm going to select Yes Network Connection, Search Options, and I'm going to specify the IP address that I actually entered on the front panel of the printer. So I know that I have this IP scheme, and number 80 was free on my network, so I typed in on the printer on the front panel 192.168.0.80. All right, so then I'm going to click OK, and then I'm going to click OK again. All right, and now it's going out specifically on that Ethernet address. Ignore this. This is that old thing that it couldn't find. This is the printer driver in itself. So now, since I specified the IP address, it was actually able to go out and find it. So I click OK. All right, and that adds the printer driver. All right, so
typically you won't have to go in and do that extra download the printer driver and specify the IP address, but if you have any difficulties with your network in the software driver automatically finding the printer, then that's a good workaround. Download the printer driver, install it by itself, then specify the exact IP address of the printer. So now we're going to show you how to print to the P800 with the standard Epson P800 driver. Right now we're in Adobe Photoshop, so we're going to go to File, then Print. It's going to bring up the print dialog box. And before we get into specific print settings, I want to go ahead and select my profile that I want to print with and how I want to handle my color management. So for the best results, I want to let Photoshop manage my colors. And then I can select from my ICC profiles depending on what type of paper I'm printing on. So here are all the standard P800 profiles that shipped with the printer. Now at DTG, we offer to our customers custom ICC profiles that we call HDR profiles. These profiles are created with very expensive equipment and some proprietary methods that allow us to get better gamut as well as DMAX. So I'm gonna go ahead and select our P800 Hot Press Bright profile. In terms of the options down here, this is very subjective. You can go with relative colorimetric or perceptual for rendering intent. Depends on the image and your media. A lot of different scenarios, but really either one will be acceptable, but you can get better results depending on the file. Next, I'm going to hit print settings. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and set my page size. My existing file right now is 16.2 by roughly 11 or 17 by 12. So I'm going to go ahead and go to Manage Custom Sizes just so you see how to do it. I'm going to say I've got a 17-inch sheet by 22-inch sheet, all right, and click OK. All right, so that will basically center my image in a 17 by 22. All right, the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to click on this layout drop list and go down to printer settings. These are the printer specific driver settings. So I'm going to go in here and select my page setup in terms of what my paper feed is. So for fine art, I'm going to pick front feed fine art. All right. Then for media type, I'm going to pick the appropriate media type for what I'm printing on. So this really needs to match my ICC profile base setting. Okay, so this is Hot Press Bright. That's what my profile was built on, so I'm gonna select Hot Press Bright. All right, your next thing is your quality and your print quality. You'll notice that print mode and color mode are automatically turned off because the driver is intelligent. It sees that Photoshop is managing colors, so it says, hey, I don't need to manage colors, turn me off. All right, and it handles that automatically, really nice. All right, so in terms of output resolution and print quality, I print everything that we do in terms of samples and demos and trying, you know, to show these printers off actually at 1440. You can print at 2880. Believe it or not, you can actually see sometimes better results at 1440. This will definitely use more ink. But again, I recommend 1440, not necessarily 2880. So we're going to select 1440. High speed in my case is checked, and that's basically print bidirectional. And I do that because I took the time to do that print head alignment that we showed you earlier in the setup video. If you didn't do the print head alignment, and you had this checked, you might see some ghosting or some artifacting with the text or, you know, fine lines because you didn't take the time to do the alignment. But since I did, I'm going to check that. We'll get faster printing, and we're basically ready to print at this point. So I'll hit save. You can now see the preview is centering my image in my custom sheet, and I'll just hit print, and it's ready to go.
So this completes our setup of the new Epson P800 desktop 17-inch printer. Just to remind you, DTG does sell and support the Epson P800 printer along with all of the ink and paper and media supplies for it. We also offer our custom HDR profiles, which are a step and above and beyond the standard ICC profiles that come with Epson, and even custom ICC profiles, offering increased DMAX and also expanded color gamut. The printer truly is a great printer. The new HD ink set does indeed offer a greater DMAX. Also consider, again, if you haven't purchased yet,
The Epson 4900 printer, if you're doing a lot of printing, that cost per milliliter does come down and can give you a greater return on your investment. So I appreciate it. If you have any questions, feel free to give us a call at 800-681-0024 or visit our website at www.dtgweb.com. Thanks.